This presentation is the third in a series on Raja Yoga. So far, we have looked briefly into four of the eight limbs of yoga. Let us refresh our mind with some of what we have looked into and keep it near rather than far. Yama is the intelligent avoidance of all that is not conducive to aspiration, and Niyama, its counterpart, is better choices in place of habit. These are very different from virtues, as they are meant to expand consciousness from an individual or self-centered living to a broader, more universal way of living. The mind is gradually purified as we learn to act or respond to life based on what actually is, instead of being rooted in self-centeredness. Through asana, one brings firmness to the posture and mind at the same time, removes the lethargy of the body and mind as well. All through asana practice, one discovers the presence of chit shakti, or intelligence energy, that sustains his body very well, without the need for ego personality. Pranayama is its counterpart, and through regulation of prana, or life force, it removes the tossing of the mind. Asana and pranayama thus bring stability and fixity to the body and mind, and at the same time give insight into chit shakti, which sustains the body. These four limbs bring us to the fifth, pratyahara, which is usually translated as abstraction from objects. Let us try to understand pratyahara in a broader way, and for this, let us make use of the word object for all things external, including people, conditions, and things, to make it easier. Pratyahara is usually translated as abstraction from objects. We do not usually associate with objects, and I'm using this in the widest sense of the term to include people, conditions, and things, but with our ideas of them. So there is an idea of the object, and there is a tendency based on that idea, both these in the same space of the one mind. Say I eat an apple for the first time and find that it is very juicy and sweet. These qualities get associated with the apple in my mind indistinguishably. Now, I find this to be very tasty and I have a feeling to repeat the experience of juicy and sweet for which I must naturally have the apple. Already, the apple becomes secondary to the very juicy, sweet, and tasty qualities which I have superimposed on the apple. This does not mean that apples are not juicy, sweet, or tasty, but all apples are not this way. Some apples are tart. So when I eat a tart apple, we find this to be not quite as tasty, as the sweetness we experienced is not experienced. There is absolutely nothing wrong with a slightly tart apple. It is delicious in its own way, but not what we expected. The object does not correspond to the idea of the object, and so the experience is not as good. The fault is never in the object, but in the collision of the object, what actually is, as it is, with our ideas, hopes, and expectations. All our problems are because of this inner collision of ideas, hopes, and expectations with reality or things as they are. In pratyahara, the entire mind is included in the field of observation along with all objects or things external. This fire of observation keeps existing concepts from interfering with perception or seeing things as they are, and our action or response without standing outside all things. Direct perception is the flow of attention to what actually is, and this is also called dharana or concentration, where the rays of the mind flow unimpeded or unscattered to what actually is, and we will look into this more deeply a little later. Pratyahara is abstraction, which results when there is this fire of observation, which ignites dharana or concentration to see what actually is. While pratyahara includes the mind into the field of observation, it keeps what is not out, ideas, hopes, and expectations or concepts from interfering with both perception and response. Why should thought tell me when what I see is directly in front of me each time? When you realize that it is not only possible, but better to let the inner intelligence directly see and respond to situations, the mind, which is not at all efficient as it is heavily laden with so many hopes and desires, is unburdened. The energy that was all along being expended to try and fulfill our hopes and desires was being done to bring about satisfaction and peace. And one sees that this comes not from trying to make the outer world correspond to the inner world, but by adjusting the inner world to what actually is as it happens. Pratyahara is in this way the release of the load of desires, hopes, and expectations, and also results in the emptying of the mind of all these hidden triggers of action. Static memory happens automatically, and this just comprises of images, names, or data, and it is very useful in recalling information without interfering with the object as such. But dynamic memory, however, is purely subjective. Its energy is called rajas or passion, which gets infused, as it were, into the object, making it difficult to see things as they really are. When the entire activity of the mind is included in the field of perception, things are seen as they are without adulteration or interference of conditioning, and rajas or blind passion is gradually thinned out by disuse. When the inner intelligence is used, existing notions, concepts, and ideas are starved of their energy, and static memory or images and names, which helps in distinguishing one from the other, alone remain. The calm and peace that results as the scattered rays of the mind once again return give rise to a sense of inner fullness and completeness. Renunciation of desires is no loss at all. It is at once peace and gain only. Objects will still be there and can be enjoyed as they come naturally. But the torment of hopes that craves for the outer to correspond with the inner is abandoned. When desires are abandoned, one enjoys all things better, contrary to the notion that fulfillment of desires is satisfaction, as it is desires that is a wanting that does not even satisfy during appeasement. Pratyahara and dharana go together, just as the earlier pairs of the limbs of yoga we have covered. There must be dharana or direct perception of things as they are, and at the same time, the mind must be included in the observation. Pratyahara or abstraction makes sure that the senses do not associate with the objects wrongly based on the existing notions of the mind that have nothing to do with things as they are. The mind thus gets purified of its dross, the conditioning it has carried for so long, and it now becomes stable and fit for concentration and meditation to follow. A mind that is filled with hopes, desires, and expectations is not fit for concentration. Before going any further, it is important to realize that pratyahara, or any step in yoga, is not a technique, though it may involve technique or practice. It is not possible to be the same old person with the same old mind that functions in the same old way and hope that yoga will bring about improved experiences. Don't delude yourself in this. Yoga calls for radical transformation by living in a different way that requires and results in a new person, renewed by returning to the natural state. For this, we must see things as they are, ourselves included, and respond to situations by doing what needs to be done, and not what we would like to do or what would please our people. If there is no enthusiastic willingness to let go of limitation, the gates to wider experiences will stay closed by our own choice. To bring about pratyahara, one must first see the futility and absurdness of all limitation, not selective limitation, but all limitation, and be passionate about bringing about change, just as one is when he is submerged underwater and passionate about surfacing to breathe, but without desperation at all. The mind now becomes stable and fit for concentration and meditation to follow. A mind filled with hopes and desires and expectations is not fit for concentration or meditation. Japa is repetition of a mantra or name of God, and is the best way to begin understanding and changing the inner mechanism. I have covered this in an earlier writing, so let's look at how japa can help in pratyahara or abstraction. When you repeat and listen to the mantra mentally, you soon experience the rise of other thoughts we call distraction. Almost immediately, one is either distracted by identifying with the thought, or one experiences dissatisfaction by the presence of these other thoughts which one had hoped not to experience in japa. Both the rise of another thought and the feeling about that rising are taking place in the same mind, and you are aware of both. Continue repeating the mantra and listening to the mantra within you, seeing the rise and fall of both distractions and the feeling about distractions as well in the same mind, and you will understand that you are quite different from even these feelings, which have a big hand in throwing up the distractions. The direct observation and understanding of this will bring great peace and melt into concentration and meditation. Yoga practices are not relegated to the mat or prayer area. They must enter life. When yoga enters life, life enters yoga. The understanding by your direct awareness must enter all of life and relationships. You must be able to see things as they are and respond to what needs to be done without the interference of thought or condition. There is no suppression or any such thing in avoiding thought, just a choice to use the inner intelligence which is beyond thought and always awake and ready. Thought has gained far too much importance in our lives by excessive reliance. It will regain its place as a function of awareness or consciousness by using awareness or consciousness itself. Just as you are fresh in attention to the mantra each time, you have to be inwardly fresh to each and every situation as it happens, and once it is over, let it go. Don't continue juggling with it mentally, or you will increase conditioning. There should not be any struggle in this, as once a situation is over, another is right in its place, and it should have your full attention. even if it be sweeping the floor. If you practice japa diligently with heart, mind, body, and non-mechanically, you will discover that you are quite different from these images and feelings towards them or conditioning, and how to continue doing what needs to be done without getting mixed up with them. Practice on the mat will sharpen the ability to function in a healthier way amidst the stimulus of life. Being able to see things as they are and doing what needs to be done will sever the reliance on thought or existing conditioning, and not dwelling on it mentally when the action is over will prevent the buildup of new conditioning. Thus, practice on the mat will sharpen the ability to respond to life better, and life lived expertly will deepen your practice. Both these avenues will feed on each other and purify the mind of the heavy load it has carried for too long. Your health and energy levels will improve significantly, as energy wasted is returned to the body for repair and other functions. Now, my friends, I know this chart looks very daunting and you're probably out there trying to read it, but it's better not to. And if you listen, you can download the text of this from the website and follow along later. The first five limbs of the yoga system are the qualifications of the seeker, and ignoring or taking any of them lightly will cause a soft spot or vulnerability. These five limbs of yoga, yama, niyama, asana, pranayama, and pratyahara, correspond to the fourfold qualifications of the seeker of jnana yoga or sadhana chatushtaya. These include viveka or proper discernment between the real and unreal, vairagya or absence of passion, shatsampat or the six virtues which include shama or tranquility, dhamma or intelligent control of the organs of sense and action, uparati or the movement of from self-centeredness to universality, which by the way is pratyahara here, titiksha, or fortitude and power of endurance, shraddha, or unmistakable, unshakable faith in God, and samadhan, or one-pointedness of mind. Those six make up the third of the four called shatsampat, or the six virtues. And then you have mumukshutva, or intense yearning for liberation from samsara, the never-ending cycle of birth, existence, and death. This comes later in one of the sutras of Patanjali when he talks of tivram samvegatva. I brought this up just to show you that each system of yoga, whether it be Raja Yoga, Jnana Yoga, or whatever, insists on certain qualifications. And as we transition from Pratyahara into Dharana, it is important to look side by side and know what these are. Finally, before moving on to dharana or concentration, a few thoughts. The sincere seeker must give up all ideas of separation which manifest in the feelings of I and mine, and then burst forth into you and yours, this and that, and so on. This is the loom on which the fabric of conditioning weaves itself, and all resulting limitation is therefore self-sought and self-imposed. You alone can dismantle and abandon this machinery, and though it is a very difficult task, it will not daunt the sincere seeker. My friends, we have come a long way, but we still have miles to go. Let us now journey on to dharana, or concentration. Dharana, or concentration, is a steady flow of attention in one direction toward object or idea. Dharana increases inner strength by reducing distractedness and increasing efficiency. The depth of dharana or concentration increases sattva or inner clarity and balance. In the beginning, it is good to fix a mind on something external, like a picture of one's deity, a candle flame, a rose, or anything that you feel will hold your interest and awareness. It is good not to change the object of concentration, though you may experiment just a little initially. The important point is that you must be very interested in the object, or else the rise of distractions which you are interested in will carry away your attention. The object of concentration becomes a target to steady the flow of attention and the mind's habit to scatter lessons. Some prefer to concentrate on something abstract from the start instead of something tangible, and feel best to concentrate with their eyes closed. There is nothing wrong with this, except the choice must be because you feel you can do this and not as some kind of bold, ambitious move. You can always start with something tangible and then shift to the abstract by abstract ideas associated with the picture or image and concentrate with your eyes closed. Proceed slowly but with firm steps and you will lay a good foundation for meditation. Missteps will demand a return to the basics, and backtracking in practice, my friends, is not a good way to travel. Proceed in concentration with firm footing and understand, and soon you will know that you are able to concentrate on subtler objects and themes. Let us walk through a simple practice of concentration. It is best to listen attentively. You can download this video and the complete text from my website. It would be hard to read and listen at the same time. Let us begin. Make sure that neither cell phones, landlines, or any other devices enter the room if you wish to practice. Otherwise, this is not for you. Sit in a cross-legged position with or without a cushion, however you feel comfortable. If you cannot sit cross-legged, sit on a chair, but keep your back straight and your feet uncrossed, flat on the floor. Use a timer for the duration you select. It is good to start with 12 to 15 minutes, as it takes a little time to get settled in initially. The object of concentration should be at eye level, so that the neck can be kept straight without tilting. Gaze at the object of concentration and let your attention form a steady link in its flow to the object. Become aware of every detail in the object while watching within also, as thoughts about it will try to interfere in the color and perception or assessment. Take an interest in the discovery by direct observation, but without allowing a concept to form about it. This is possible if you continue to observe keenly. More and more detail will become observable and the mind will get saturated by the object. You will be able to close your eyes momentarily and not lose the flow of attention, as the object will be seen within quite clearly. Try to keep the eyes open for as long as possible. Initially, the eyes may start watering somewhere at the 6 to 8 minute mark. Let them close gently a little before and continue to concentrate on the object within. As the image within starts losing clarity, open the eyes and there should be seamless observation where you do not feel outside or inside as being any different. The mind will try to connect observation with all kinds of thoughts. Be steady and feel with every breath that you are observing afresh. Let the thoughts rise and they will fall on their own accord. You will discover a great secret If you leave these other thoughts and feelings about them as well alone, they will leave you alone too. They just come and do no harm. The important thing is not to break the ray of attention or the object of concentration till the timer sounds. Say some prayers and leave the area gracefully. Now that we have encountered distractions, let us try to understand them. We have already discussed a little of this earlier under Pratyahara, but let's relook at some of the important points. During concentration, other thoughts will rise in the mind, and almost instantly, an urge will be felt to think about them, to dwell on them, or to participate in the thoughts. This, my friends, is a very important point. You must be aware of the rise of these other thoughts and also of the urge to think on them. Often, we see the thoughts that rise or the images, but are not aware of this urge to think on them. And when that urge arises, we get swept away, getting ourselves mixed up with the urge. The image or thought is static memory and harmless. Often it is used as an avenue for the strong feeling or dynamic memory which craves repetition. This is the trigger of action. Example of this in our daily life is if you are angry with someone, the anger may vent on others, though they have nothing to do with why you are angry. So what to do about them? How do we go beyond distractions? As we have noted, we are concentrating on the object of concentration or meditation, and both the other thought and the surging urge to dwell on it are not us, but something rising in us like waves in an ocean. The urge may still hold the image for a short time, but it will fall fast as the urge and image or thought exhaust each other by lack of fresh energy, by you not identifying with them. The interest you take in the object of meditation or concentration will raise the quality of flow of attention towards it and make the urge a little more distinguishable. It is here many seekers struggle, as the mind wants to flow towards what they call distractions, which are just other thoughts of interest that seem a little bit more interesting than their object of concentration. The rise and fall of other thoughts, or what we call distractions, is not the problem. Neither is the urge to dwell on them, but to slip in attention, to get mixed up with the urge and start expanding the thought, is distraction. When you are distracted, you shift from the tract intended to another tract, never having become aware. As long as you feel you are doing something in concentration, you are susceptible to this dislodging. If you feel it is not just something you are doing, but looking directly within, which is being, it will hold you steadier. As being is not just existence, it is also aware of existence at the same time. Doing need not always be connected with being, but being is capable of doing as part of being itself. As part of itself. When a mother sees a child in some danger, it is not her physical frame that responds, but being who she is. The very existence in her sees the danger that must be addressed, and all of her rises into action. I'm discussing this here, my friends, because dharana makes us enter into the inner court of yoga. There are some different opinions about what constitutes the inner court. The first five limbs which we have covered and their elements work on developing the seeker for this inner adventure, which is an act of being, and being does what is needed. The ego cannot do yoga.
It is one action of Pratyahara and Dharana.
Pratyahara arouses and awakens inner intelligence as the mind is brought into the field of observation along with things outside. The direct observation of the mind is abstraction or withdrawal from concepts, ideas, habit, or conditioning. The same intelligence also directly perceives what is outside, and this flow of attention is called dharana or concentration. Interruption or distraction is not the rise and fall of other thoughts or urges, but an interruption or shift in your own attention from what you intend to observe to something else due to the inability to concentrate. When the inner intelligence watches the mind or within and at the same time flows uninterruptedly towards the object of attention or outside, there is a single movement of pratyahara and dharana, or abstraction and concentration. Let us look at some of the benefits of pratyahara and dharana. Meditation will come naturally to one who practices concentration. A distracted mind is a breeding ground for all kinds of physical and mental illnesses. A concentrated mind will manifest itself in good health, abundant energy, and will never cause worry, suspicion, or be anxious. It will always extend its best effort when every situation presents itself. One becomes very efficient in all things, and has high output as wastage of all sorts is eliminated. Newer skills will be learnt more easily, as the concentrated mind does not have any inner resistance. The most difficult and trying of situations will be handled with calm, equipoise, and finesse, and one will walk lightly where others tread heavy. Now, some practical hints before we close. Yoga is non-division, and this already is. We have created division, and now we seek to overcome this. Yoga must enter life at every step and in every way, or life will not enter yoga and it'll become a set of techniques. These will help. Do one thing at one time and do it with full concentration and heart. Once done, don't continue to dwell on it. Done means done, mentally too. All action has equal value. Nothing is secular or mundane, as actions are a mirror in which we see our motives and we have an opportunity to do what needs to be done as part of the situation itself without trying to stand outside things with a personal motive. Yama and Niyama lay the foundation for a healthy arrangement with people, things, and conditions outside, as well as within, in the inner world. It brings order to the mind, and this ordered mind can start building positively. Asanas and pranayama not only purify the body and energy pathways, they renew healthy connections in the subtle pathways and increase the psychic energy which will be needed for pratyahara and dharana to follow. The base of the first four will eliminate any soft spots or areas one is most likely to fall. It does not mean that one should not or cannot practice concentration and meditation from the beginning, but that the fundamentals should not be brushed over casually or overconfidently. To increase sattva, clarity and balance, one has to decrease tamas and rajas. The practice of asanas and pranayama will help only if one consciously thins desires and passions that will always ignite the embers of rajas again. Practicing asana and pranayama and still living a life filled with desires, hopes and expectations is like walking far each day to get water with a bucket full of holes. Be wise and know where to start. Proceed gradually but with sure footing, and you will not have to backtrack. Backtracking in all ways and regrets of all sorts are two very serious obstacles for the seeker and must be avoided. These first six limbs of yoga seem difficult and perhaps even boring at first, because we are always used to doing something in order to get something good, pleasant, and better. If you approach yoga with this attitude, you will find it quite unappetizing, unpleasant, and even distasteful or painful. Yoga is a journey that seeks to know the truth at every stage. In the initial stages, you will see the truth about your own self, the condition of your mind, and the force of habit, and this may not be pleasant if you came here to feel good. If, however, you came to yoga to know the truth, to see your mind, the inner world, and feelings as they are, however turbulent, it will be a good thing, as you will know what needs to be done next. A seeker of truth must embrace the truth right from the beginning in his or her heart. And if this has been done, one will never have regrets or any use for the rearview mirror. One will march forward boldly and confidently, but gently and with humility. Next, we look at meditation. The mat or field of practice includes all of life. Be diligent in your practice. For more information, to download this video or the text of this presentation, please visit suryadevananda.org. Thank you.